mentioned to you guys, I was told I had 20 minutes, and now I just found out I have 15 minutes. So, and of course, the problem is, you know, trying to cover everything about leather in 20 minutes is very, very tough. So, we start with, does leather really come from cows? And what I hope to convey to you is a basic understanding of how leather is made and some different terms that can be used to define leather. So without further ado, where does leather come from? Most leather comes from these four animals. Cows, pigs, sheep, and goats. Very, very simple, very, very basic. Leather is a byproduct of the food industry. Obviously, that's already been said many times today already. And no animal is killed for its hide or its skin to make leather. And converting raw hides into leather obviously saves a huge load from the landfills. I think in the beef industry, the U.S. does, what, 30 million a year. If you took 30 million hides every year and put into a landfill, the human health hazard of that would be tremendous. So obviously we don't want to do that. And leather is a durable and versatile material. Lisa pointed out before how you can take something in the same animal and just a little different subtleties in the chemistry, you can make a baseball leather to, it's very tinny, very tight, doesn't include or cause the ball to have more home runs, right? And that's not going on now because of the leather. But you can go from an Allentown cowhide baseball leather all the way to an upholstery leather or to a glove leather. Same basic material. Which I think is pretty awesome. Meat processors, where the leather comes from. Some tan the hides on site, and others preserve them for transport, but basically it's a global industry now. The hides are created globally. You'll have a lot of hides from the U.S. going to foreign countries, Italy, Vietnam, China, all over the world, basically. The tannery process, the first stage of the tannery goes into the beam house. The name of the beam house came from the name of the actual, one of the actual pieces of equipment in the very beginning. Basically, it's four different processes, soaking, unhairing, buffing, and pickling. It's all controlled by pH. Does everyone remember what pH is all about from your high school chemistry class? You know, you got acid versus base. That all works in the tannery. When I first started with leather, I met our tanner, and he was from the Ukraine, and he didn't really believe the pH meters. He always liked to taste things to make sure that it was really acid or it was really base. It took a while, but we did convince him that the meter is right. It really is right. But his skin kind of had a greenish tone to it. Soaking is the first process. The raw hides would come into the tannery, it would be soaked in water, basically, and you're removing any kind of dung and dirt, any kind of blood that's in the hides. You may notice this picture here is a wooden vessel, and it looks very primitive, very old, but actually that is a very good thing to do because a wooden drum in this particular application lasts longer than a metal or a plastic one would. So this drum is probably like 60 or 70 years old. And it forms an equilibrium with the solution, and away you go. So it works out very well. After the soaking, it goes into an unhairing. And this operation, like I said, is pH-driven. It's very high pH, in the 12 pH range, using lime and sodium sulfide. And as you can see, they're using a cement mixer form here. This is an operation that uses less water than the previous version. One thing I'd like to convey is that all the tanners in the world are trying to do more with less. They're trying to use more efficient chemistry, more efficient mechanical processes. And this the cement mixer is one of those. Baiting and pickling is a very simple step. It uses the enzymes to clean up the hide, the leather itself. So it's using a naturally occurring organism to improve the leather surface. And salts are used to lower the pH of the hide. One thing to keep in mind is the leather structure itself is a fibrous system, and it's a very complicated network. You can't change things very quickly because of that. It's a very slow process. Splitting is done at this stage. Lime splits, and in this there's a lot of variation on how thick it may be, but a bovine hide may be about 5 or 7 millimeters thick. If you want to come up with an upholstery leather at 1.2 millimeters thick, you have to split it at some point. And at the line stage is a real thick stage to do it. Cutting is easy and precise. If you consider a wet hide being easy to cut, it is easy to cut in this stage. And actually the leather comes out a little bit softer. And the bottom part is used for other things. It can be used for sausage casings, dog chews, gummy bears, that kind of thing. Collagen, it's a source of collagen. This also saves process chemicals and reduces waste rot. To give you an idea of what it looks like, you have the top of grain. This would be there where the hair is hide, and versus the what we call the flesh side. And this, you get the full grain, cut grain, and nubuck out of here, and you get suede and mill splits and finished splits down below. That gives the idea that this is splitting. This is done on a horizontal bandsaw type arrangement with a razor blade, basically cutting the hide. Tanning is obviously the next stage. 90 to 95% of the world's leather is tanned in chrome. The rest of it is finished tanned. Tannage is by a chromium sulfate, which there's a chemistry. And the chrome 3 is the active agent during the tanning. I was told not to do a whole lot of science. So that's as raw as we get. But basically, the chrome molecule is forming a ladder with the collagen molecules. So you're getting a ladder chain to stabilize the collagen fibers to prevent them from degrading. And that works very, very effectively. And chrome is probably one of the fastest and most stable forms of tanning. As I said, the pH is a driver for this whole thing. Remember, we did the line split. The hide was up here in the 12 range. You had to bring it all the way down to 3 to actually start the pH. It's very, very important to control the penetration of how it goes. At the end of the tanning process, for chrome leather, you have wet material like this, and it is called wet glue, actually. And there's minimal chrome in the water, and most of it is in the leather itself. Chemical manufacturers in the leather industry and the tanners themselves are working very, very diligently to make the tanning process as efficient as possible. But all the chrome that you offer the hides, they all go in the hides. And there's very little of the wastewater. I was going to talk about just chrome and bench tanning, but I think oil tanning is a very cool thing. Chamois leather is very cool. It's a totally different process as far as the tanning goes. It's done in a pressure type cooker, and it uses the fish oil. But the thing is, it gives you, it allows the leather to absorb 600% of its weight, and it dries to 180% and stays nice and soft. And it has no grease to it. And I like to consider it nature's microfiber. We hear more and more in the news about how microfibers are getting into our wastewater, into our water streams, and you know, it'll last forever. But on the side of the chamois, if it gets into the water, it will eventually degrade because it's only oil tanned. It's just been out. And the oil is actually a fish oil, so it's a very natural product. And if you ever get a lot of fingerprints on your cell phone, get a chamois. It cleans it up real nice. Real nice. And dries off. I like the taste of my microfiber. All right, bench tanning is the other big operation for tanning. Leaves and pods and bark. They can be from any kind of a thing. Taro trees, ratio, oak, you name it, can be used in tanning. This tanning is done in different type of vessels. These are more of a static vessel, a pit of some kind. It's a very large vessel. It's a very slow process. Very time intensive. If you look at the process time for like chrome tanning, it may take about 8 hours or a little bit more than 8 hours. Bench tanning can take up a month or more. So it's a very, very different process. There's a comparison. I thought I'd do a little comparison to tell you the advantages and disadvantages of bench versus chrome tanning. Bench tan leather is very hydrophilic. So it absorbs a lot of the water, very much so, whereas the chrome tan a little afterglow. Generally, what we find in the laboratory is if any application requires flame resistance, it's usually like aircraft leather or very high firefighter gloves or fuel handler gloves for the military. But like automotive leather, it doesn't need any additives to pass the flame requirements in that application. Veg tan has a lower shrink temperature than chrome tan. Chrome tan will shrink at 100 degrees centigrade or so, whereas veg tan probably more like 70 degrees. So if you need a high shrink resistant type leather, chrome is the way to go for that. If you veg tan leather is firmer, low elongation and low elasticity, whereas the chrome tan is a softer, higher elongation and more elasticity, more rubbery. And veg tan obviously does good tooling and good embossing, and chrome tan by itself is very good for that. Leather is generally a very good insulated material when it comes to gloves. The veg tan is a little bit lower thermal conductivity, so it's a little bit better insulator than the chrome, but we've done some studies in the lab trying to change the thermal characteristics of leather, and we weren't able to actually get anything quantitatively different, but some people had, they were sitting on the seats and they subjectively felt that one was better than the other, but we couldn't really determine it. So, at the end, we're still at the wet blue stage, wet white stage. Wet white is the veg tan, tanned in this process. The next processes would be the shaving, retan, coloring, and fat lacquering. Shaving is again trying to come up with the right thickness. One of the things, if you want a leather that is only 1 millimeter thick at the very end, you have to adjust the splitting and the shaving way up in your process to get to that end. It's a whole coordinated process. The next stage would be retan, coloring, and fat lacquering. This is a process that's usually done all at one time in one vessel, and like a continuous sequence. With the retan, you can do combination tanning. Coloring is where you want to get the final color of your end product. You start to get it that way. Remember, it was white-blue before, so you're coming to what kind of color you're looking for. And also, you took all the fats out of the hide in the beam house process. You stripped them all out, and you're going to put them back in. Because if you don't have enough fat lacquers in there, the fibers themselves are not going to a slide, you're going to break. So you're going to have a weaker leather. And it won't be as flexible. This, though, in the retan operation, you can get really customized with this. You can do things like you can make it waterproof. You can change the cold characteristics of it, make the water just run right off the hide, which makes a very nice poop. And you can also make a little pull-up type leather. This, I couldn't get a good image of this, but this is basically where you take a leather, you put some pressure on it underneath, that'll change the color, it'll move the oils around, make it a little bit lighter than that where you put it under pressure. But if you relax it, it'll eventually go right back to the original work. It's very cool. And you can also do deep embossing. As I said before, chrome tan leather is very rubbery, it doesn't hold anything. But if you want to have a product that has a deep embossing, you put a little bit of veg tan material in the retan operation, and that way you get the high shrink temperature of the chrome, and you also get the embossing properties of the veg tan. So you can customize and make it more applicable for what you're trying to do. And obviously, you can optimize the haptics of it and give you a nice round hand of leather, or a very flat hand of leather, depending on what you're looking for. If you're looking at something like baseball leather, it's going to be a very flat, very tinny type of a hand versus a garment leather, which you want to have a nice brown hand, nice soft hand. That's all done in the retan and the fat cutting stages. Further processes in the tannery, you're talking about drying, softening, and finishing. Drying is not just a simple oven anymore. It's a very complicated process. Toggle drying is a very popular option for this. This is where the hide is put on a toggle frame, and it's subject to some stretch. And you can see here in the image, it's a long process. This would be the hide going in, and then it's a whole product, four or five chambers. very slow with that. You don't want to dry it very fast because you'll have some problems with water hardness and stiffness will make it stiff. The other main drying option is vacuum drying. This is basically putting the hide between vacuum plates and smoking into a vacuum to suck the water out. This actually gives you a little bit more a softer leather, softer hand with the leather, which is always everyone wants. Some leathers are more applicable for air drying. If you have a heavy vegetable tan leather or something like that, you might have air drying. Air drying is another option. Again, it depends on your final product that you're trying to shoot for. Softening computer controlled drums now. These can be cycled however you need. You can add moisture to them. You can add perfumes to them, whatever kind of that addition you need to make. And that's basically the end of the wet end process. At this point, you have what's called crust or russet, depending on which term you want to use. But the leather has been fully tanned. It's been colored. It's been retanned and retanned in fat lacquer. So it's basically ready for finishing. For finishing, there's a tremendous level of variation available. It's obviously driven by the end use requirements. Some leathers are highly finished, while others are naked. Finishing, if you go into a finishing operation today, you'll see something that's very, very well organized and very clean, because anytime you do any kind of a finishing, any dirt is going to be a detriment to your final product. So you keep them very clean and very well organized. There's also a great deal of automation in the leather handling, too. Leather itself presents quite a challenge to automation because it's not always the same shape. It's not always square. It's not always round. So you have to have the automation that can handle that kind of variation. And the finishing lines, again, it depends on what kind of leather you're making. This is a spray machine, and it is a spraying operation. Spray booth here, ovens in the middle. You can put a base coat on and then dry it a little bit, maybe, or a lot, depending on what you're trying to make, and then put another base coat on, another top coat, all kinds of variations going on here. Spraying is rotary sprays, reciprocal spraying. You can also do a roll called roll coater, which is like just putting it on with a roll, and like a printing press type thing. Again, this is an operation that is very efficient, wise as far as there's no overspray on roll coaters, and the application is recyclable, so it works out very well. The latest technology from the machine manufacturers is trying to make it so you can control the application of roll coaters as precise as you can with the spray. And I think maybe like 5 years ago, the roll coaters really didn't like do base coating because they weren't very accurate, and you had to rely on a spray coater to do a final top coat. Now I think you can do top coating even with a roll coater. So that what that does for the tanner is it makes the less emissions, less air emissions, less waste because you don't have any overspray. So again, it's trying to be more environmentally friendly. Now I want to define some of the finish types. You hear a lot of different things about full grain versus aniline versus semi-aniline and pigmented. I'm trying to give you a little bit of an idea of what each one is. Aniline leather is leather that has been dyed by immersion and has not received any coatings of pigments at all. So the finish is very, very transparent. You can see the hair follicles through the finish. And I think this aesthetics. I mean, most people, when they have a leather that's got an aniline finish, they're very, very, it's very natural, it's very nice, it's very nice. The feel is good, the look is good, and the image, it's obviously a status thing too. And it's a little bit more comfortable because it's more breathable. Generally has a softer feel to it, more breathable because there's very little finish on it. The bad part about that, or the trade-offs, is the color variation. Again, you don't have any pigmentation in there. All you have is a dye, and leather is a natural product. It's not going to dye evenly because of that. Some areas are going to be a little bit darker than others, so you'll have a little bit of variation. Semi-aniline is the same idea as the aniline, only you've got a little bit of pigment in there to cover up a little bit of the natural markings, the natural markings in the follicles. This is kind of tough, because it's semi-aniline, it's kind of in the gray area. I've tried to get some good pictures of semi-aniline leather, but it's very hard to photograph it, so you can see the real three-dimensional of it. The strength here is that you do conceal some minor natural markings, and the color is more uniform because you have a little bit of pigment in there, and the light masses will be better because you've got some pigment to help shield the leather from the color change, and special effects are possible. You can do a little bit of like a depth type thing where you have different depths. And of course, the trade-offs, though, the formulation is complex. It's a lot more difficult to actually do, but it can be done, and your application skills are higher because it can't, it's not just running through the spray machine one time. You have to balance out how you spray it to or roll it. And misrepresentation can happen because the definitions can be blurred, whether it's a semi-aniline or an aniline. Pigmented leather, this is one where the leather surface is completely obscured by the pigments. It's got a heavy pigment load on it, and you can't see any of the natural markings at all, or you can't see any of the natural hair follicles at all. And strength, obviously, maximum color uniformity, you can make it very uniform for color, and high color passes. Pigments will have a higher color passes resistance than dyes, so you will be able to do that. And your durability will be better because you've got the pigments to help protect it, and use a heavier finish to give you more protection too. And the lower cost. Obviously, the lower cost is talking about the utilization of the hides itself, because you can be able to use more because it's covered more. And you can do embossing and printing with pigment leather a lot better than the other types. The trade-offs, obviously, is the aesthetics. The handle in the field is not as good, and depth of perception, you get to look at the depth of the article, is a little bit harder to achieve like that, and it's not as good of an image as it would be. If you look in the automotive world, a vehicle that has more rustic appeal, I'm thinking of the Ford King Ranch vehicles, those were like an aniline type finish, that had a little bit more appeal than a fully finished fitment load. Top grain versus full grain leather. That question comes up a lot to the laboratory. Everyone wants to know what's the difference between top grain and full grain. Remember, we're talking about leather. It's a 3D matrix of collagen fibers, and most people agree that the beauty of the leather comes from the grain itself. And that's the very top grain. To repeat where we were, this is what we're talking about. The grain is the top where the hair is, and you get down below here and you get into the splits. So, what do they mean by top grain versus full grain? Like most people, if you Google what is the difference between top grain and full grain leather? This is the definition that Google comes up with last week. And they're saying top grain leather is similar to full grain leather, except that the top couple millimeters have been sanded and buffed to take away imperfections. That is actually wrong. Totally wrong. And I don't know about you, but I kind of do rely on Google for some things. This is kind of, I mean, this was number one issue, number one answer on Google. What it is, the full grain is basically leather bearing the original grain surface with nothing has been removed by buffing stuff or your splitting. It's totally intact. Nothing has been removed. That is full grain. That's the official definition. Top grain is referring to that grain split at the top of the hide. It's not talking about the anything else, just talking about the top. The top Google results say the top couple of millimeters have been sanded and buffed to take away any imperfections. That's actually defining corrected grain leather, which is totally different than that. Corrected leather is basically when you have the leather's been partially removed by buffing to a depth covered by whatever kind of defects you're trying to cover. This is done on a buffing machine, and it's basically a giant machine with rollers covered with sandpaper. You're basically sanding the leather. You've got sanding belts, and then full hide. because it can last a long time.
Yes.
We won't argue. Anyway, correct and letter. If you look at different levels of corrections, you may hear people talk about it's not corrected at all, or it's only snuffed, or it's only buffed. Well, here's the, I've got three examples of different degrees of buffing. Snuffed is where you just take a light sanding off to take those little high points off, and you get into more buff, it's a little bit deeper, and you do a heavy buff, you're just grinding it off more layers. So there's a number of different degrees. And of course, you've got to remember that the leather itself has got different thicknesses throughout the hide itself. So if you try to take a little bit off of one area, you may take a little bit more off of another area or nothing off of some areas. So it's going to be a variation. So any kind of a control to this product is going to have to be a visual control to your operators. And awesome. I think you're going to see in the show next door here, and probably tomorrow in the LA, all the different kinds of embossings that can be done. You can emboss with a plate, depending on what kind of look you're going for, or a roll, depending on the look and the volume. There's all kinds of variations. You can do specialty finishes, you can make a suede. Remember, the suede is from the one of the middle splits, whereas the new buck is from the grains. You have the grain surface, but the grain surface is buffed enough to leave a nice nap. Make a new buck. And you get into other specialty finishes, like two-tones, antiques, there's foils, tipping. This is actually a leather that was heavily embossed, and then it was sprayed to give you a base color, and then it was embossed to raise those knobs up, and then it was tipped with a roll coater to give it a little bit of color, and that's to make it look like ostrich leather. It's actually cowhide. But if you want to make something that looks like ostrich, but don't pay for ostrich, there you go.